Greetings, everyone out there in TV land, and welcome to the Saturday afternoon Science Fiction Hour, presented to you by American Motors, in association with Sci-Fi and more moving pictures. This week's adventure takes place in the golden age of science fiction movies, counting down to the top 10 science fiction movies of the 1950s. This week's episode brought to you in part by Pepsodent Toothpaste. You'll wonder where the yellow went when you brush your teeth with Pepsodent. And by Hasbro's new Mr. Potato Head doll. You can stick multiple eyes, ears, and a mouth on this spud. And when you're finished, you can cook him before the potato rots. And now, here's your host, Mike Cosmos. Greetings, Planeteers, and welcome to Sci-Fi and More's Top 10 Countdown of Sci-Fi Movies from the 1950s. The 1950s gave the world the early years of what might be considered the modern science fiction movie experience, with special effects really being born in the first half of the 50s, with things like rockets, flying saucers, radioactivity and mutation, mind and body control, alien invasion, robots, and even dinosaur resurrection. This advancement in science fiction gave the films of 1951 through 1956 the title of the Golden Age of science fiction movies. The Golden Age movies had many moving parts and topics of the time that were almost always integrated into those early films. These films didn't just pop onto the scene in the 50s. There were influential classics that had their beginnings before World War II. Movies like 1916's 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea and 1927's Metropolis. But it wasn't until 1945 and the ushering in of the atomic age that made science a hot topic. Then, in 1950, Hollywood could see what they had on their hands and they ran with the ball. While I was making this video gave me an opportunity to revisit some of my favorite sci-fi movies from this era that I used to watch on the Saturday afternoon creature feature show when I was a kid. Honestly, I forgot how good some of these movies were for the time. There are some honorable mentions that didn't make our list, like 1951's The Man from Planet X, 1953's Invaders from Mars, 1953's It Came from Outer Space, 1955's The Atomic Man, and 1958's The Space Children. These movies didn't necessarily age well by today's standard, and Hollywood hasn't come knocking on the door to do an updated version of these movies, but they're still fun to watch. So what we decided to do was rank the 10 most popular films that came out during this era. So pause right there, run out to the concession stand and grab yourself some popcorn and a drink, and let's enjoy some top 10 sci-fi movies from the 1950s. Number 10. The Blob, 1958. A mysterious creature from another planet, resembling a giant blob of jelly, lands on the Earth inside of a falling meteor. After teenagers Steve Andrews and his girlfriend Jane Martin see the meteorite crash, they set off to investigate. They come across an old man who seems to have some type of gelatinous matter stuck to his hand. Worried for his well-being, they take him to see Dr. Helen, who isn't sure what the substance is, but Steve becomes convinced it's a monster after both the old man and the doctor vanish. The creature seems to have an insatiable appetite as it consumes more and more people, growing larger and larger in the process. Naturally, the townspeople refuse to listen to Steve and Jane, who have witnessed the blob's destructive power as more and more people vanish and the creature continues to grow larger. While investigating the strange creature, Steve and Jane come face to face with the blob in a grocery store and decide to hide in a walk-in refrigerator. The blob starts to ooze under the door, but then suddenly retreats. Steve and Jane escape and set off the town's alarms to warn the town of the looming danger facing them. In one of the most classic scenes of the movie, the townspeople and the police are in a rage and confront Steve. The blob enters the Colonial Theater, which is showing the 1955 horror classic, Daughter of Horror, and begins consuming the projectionist before oozing into the camera's seating area. It isn't until a diner owner uses a CO2 fire extinguisher to put out a fire in his diner, which reveals a potential solution to the blob problem. It seems that the CO2 causes the approaching blob to recoil. Remembering that the blob retreated from the refrigerator, Steve told the authorities that the blob apparently cannot stand the cold. With this knowledge in hand, Jane's father takes Steve's friends to the high school to retrieve fire extinguishers, which are used to freeze the blob. Once the blob had been stopped and frozen, the Air Force transports the blob to the North Pole to keep it frozen. In the climactic ending, a military plane is shown dropping the blob into the Arctic landscape. But at the end of the story, the film ends with the classic "The End," which then morphs into a question mark. Number 9, Journey to the Center of the Earth, 1959. For those of you that love the Hollow Earth theory, this one is a must. This story takes place in 1880 when a recently knighted Edinburgh professor, Sir Oliver Lindenbrook, believes he has discovered a very old message from a long-lost scientist who may have found the way to journey to the center of the Earth through an extinct volcano in Iceland. This sets in motion an expedition that Oliver leads to Iceland, searching for the entrance to the center of the Earth. Once the entrance is discovered, Professor Lindenbrook and his team descend into the darkness of the Earth. They find fantastic creatures, exotic plants, the lost city of Atlantis, and a foe who wants to keep knowledge of the underworld to himself. When his prize pupil, Alec McEwen, presents Oliver with a lava paperweight to commemorate his knighthood, Oliver discovers that encased within the Italian lava is a rock from Iceland. After Oliver identifies some etchings on the rock as those of an Icelandic scientist who years earlier descended into the interior of the Earth, never to return, he sends a dispatch to his colleague, Professor Göteborg, in Stockholm, asking him to confirm his findings. But Göteborg has vanished. Oliver realizes that the Swede has decided to conduct his own expedition. In a fight involving an expeditionary member named Hans, who discovered that the Count had eaten his pet duck Gertrude that he had brought on the expedition, Hans makes a lunge at the Count, pushing him against a stone wall, and when the Count tries to retreat, he is crushed by a falling pillar of rocks, revealing the sunken city of Atlantis. This is where they discover the skeleton of Professor Saknussemm, with his finger pointing to a shaft that leads to the chimney of a volcano and the way out of the underground. Number 8, Invasion of the Body Snatchers, 1956. This movie does a nice job of combining science fiction and the horror element that was still popular at the time. The movie also works in a flashback sequence from Dr. Miles Bunnell's point of view, where he is telling his story after his story has already ended. The movie centers around Dr. Miles Bunnell, who has been arrested on a California highway and taken to a local hospital psychiatric ward, where he tells psychiatrist Dr. Hill his fantastic story, that people were not who they seemed to be, but rather replaced by exact duplicates, the pod people. Some days later, Miles and his girlfriend, Becky Driscoll, are called to the home of his friend Jack, where Jack and his wife have discovered a curiously unfinished human body lying on a table in the house. It is lifeless but bears an uncomfortable resemblance to Jack. Upon this discovery of the unfinished Jack, the group of friends go to the greenhouse behind Jack's house, where they discover several human-sized pods containing more of the humanoid forms. Miles destroys these pods with a pitchfork, Jack is convinced this is an extraterrestrial invasion and tries to notify the FBI and state police, only to discover that the phone lines have been taken over by the aliens. With the residents being transformed at an alarming rate while they sleep, Miles and Becky go to Miles' office hoping to find a phone that works and hide through the night from the pursuing aliens. Next morning, they are all cornered by the pod Jack and other pod people who urge Miles and Becky to surrender peacefully. Managing to overpower their attackers, Miles and Becky escape the office. Evidently, they are the only humans left in town, and they are chased by hundreds of these pod people. It would seem, knowing that they must stay awake or be taken over, Miles and Becky take refuge in a cave while they try to elude the aliens. But while Miles goes outside to assess the situation and scout for aliens, Becky falls asleep and is replaced. Miles realizes the change when he returns and tries to kiss her. Becky is unresponsive. She calls loudly to the other aliens. Miles, now alone, runs to a nearby highway and desperately tries to stop the speeding cars, only to be ignored. Miles looks directly at the camera and shouts, "You're next." Number 7. When Worlds Collide, 1951. Now, Earth impacts and planet-ending collisions are nothing new to the sci-fi genre. They are, in fact, part of our historical past, such as the meteor that struck the Yucatan Peninsula, changing the climate of the Earth and wiping out the dinosaurs. But if there was a fun way to destroy the Earth and conveniently had a place to land to start a new world, this is the movie for you. The movie starts at an observatory in South Africa. Astronomer Dr. Henry Bronson has in his possession a black box containing top secret scientific data, with instructions to deliver it to Dr. Hendren in New York. While the data in the box is double-checked with the differential analyzer, Hendren explains to the members of the observatory board that Bronson has discovered a new planet, Zyra, circling the star Belus, and that both spheres are racing at incredible speeds towards the Earth. Bronson has predicted that in less than a year, Belus will pass close to the Earth and it will cause devastating earthquakes and tidal waves. Shortly after, Zyra will collide with the Earth, destroying it. Hendren presents Bronson's findings to the United Nations and proposes that the spaceship be built to take a few dozen people to Zyra just after it hits the Earth, although Hendren is immediately dismissed as being a nut job by some leaders. Two observatory board members pledge money to start construction of the ship. Soon after, a wheelchair-bound millionaire named Stanton agrees to finance completion of the spaceship in exchange for a spot on the passenger list. Don't you just love the gall of some people? "I'll pay to build the rocket that can save humanity, but only if I get to go." Ah, blackmail. A powerful weapon in the face of pending doom for humanity. With only 8 months to go, 600 men and women begin to work on the ship, aware that only 40 of them will be randomly selected to make the flight. Months later, as Belus and Zyra near Earth, mass evacuations begin as a series of disasters rock the planet, decimating coastal cities with floods and interior areas with earthquakes, volcanoes, and fire. With the ship all but completed, the winning lottery numbers are posted. And as Stanton has predicted, some of the workers protest their exclusion and form a mob. Fights and fires then break out, and Hendren instructs the ship's passengers to board as quickly as possible. Moments before the ships take off, Hendren, who is outside pushing Stanton in a wheelchair, refuses to board, sacrificing himself as well as the millionaire Stanton. The ship blasts off from Earth, and as the space travelers lose consciousness, Zyra collides with the Earth. Later, all of the passengers have revived as the ship makes a rocky but safe landing on the Earth-like Zyra, where the crew can now disembark and begin life in the new world. This entry simply needs no introduction. You simply cannot have a top 10 sci-fi list for the 1950s and not include the atomic breath-breathing big guy himself. Godzilla actually had two release dates. In Japan, it was released in 1954 as Gojira, and then later in the US after adding and deleting footage from the original 1954 movie, in an attempt to tailor the movie for a U.S. audience in 1956. For this adaptation, for American moviegoers, the title of Gojira would also be changed to Godzilla, King of the Monsters. The 1954 release is known as a Japanese science fiction kaiju film, produced by Toho and directed by Ishiro Honda. The plot tells the story of Godzilla, a giant monster mutated by nuclear radiation who ravages Japan, bringing back the horrors of nuclear devastation to a country that experienced it firsthand. It was the first of many kaiju films released in Japan, paving the way and setting the standard for the genre of future kaiju films, many of which feature Godzilla. But as great as Godzilla is, he wasn't always so great. I think we would all like to forget about Flying Godzilla. Am I right? Now, if we could only get a Godzilla vs. Gamera film, that would be awesome. I think the current MonsterVerse series of Godzilla films should entertain this idea. I mean, the fans have only been asking for it for 70 years. The man behind Godzilla, Ishiro Honda, was an accomplished Japanese filmmaker prior to World War II. He served in the military for the Empire of Japan during the war, and after the dropping of the atomic bombs at the end of the war, Honda was released from his captivity as a prisoner of war and went home to Hiroshima to see what had happened. What he saw would haunt him for the rest of his life, and that's when he came up with the idea for Godzilla. His original vision for Godzilla was to be a metaphor for the consequences to man for the destructive power brought on by nuclear devastation, essentially saying that Godzilla is the result of what humanity did to themselves. Unlike the other entries on this list, Godzilla is the only one that has built an ongoing storyline and film franchise spanning almost 70 years and 38 movies in total, 33 of which were produced by Toho. The franchise is recognized by the Guinness Book of World Records as the longest continuously running film franchise. These movies have shown us multiple sides of Godzilla, from a human error to a savior of humanity, being a kid-friendly hero while fighting other kaiju, space monsters, and giant robots. He was killed, brought back, killed again, brought back again. Godzilla even got in on some Ultraman action during a guest appearance in the 1960s Ultraman show as the kaiju Jiris, who would have an epic all-or-nothing showdown with Ultraman, all while trying to destroy every building in front of him. As Godzilla ravages Japan in the 1954 film, he is ultimately defeated by a weapon known as the Oxygen Destroyer, developed by the film's protagonist, Dr. Serizawa. The Oxygen Destroyer contained a chemical compound designed to remove all the oxygen from the water, causing all living creatures to die from asphyxiation as their remains liquefy. As the movie ends, Dr. Serizawa sacrifices himself in the water to ensure the Oxygen Destroyer once and for all destroys Godzilla. And that is exactly what it did, as the bones of the giant kaiju can be seen on the ocean floor as the movie fades to black. Number 5. Them, 1954. What? Giant ants, you say? Here's another movie that proves beyond the shadow of a doubt that radiation makes everything bigger. While investigating a series of mysterious deaths, Sergeant Ben Peterson finds a young girl who's unable to speak. as Peterson joins forces with FBI agent Robert Graham and scientist Dr. Harold Medford. He discovers that all the incidents are due to giant ants that have been mutated by atomic radiation. Peterson and Graham, with the aid of the military, attempt to find the queen of the ants and destroy the nests before the danger spreads. Them is another great entry on this list as an example of science fiction that merged horror elements of the time that were still popular. The film takes place in New Mexico. Police Sergeant Ben Peterson finds a little girl who is stunned and unresponsive, walking through the desert, tightly gripping her damaged doll. After Ben finds the little girl, he finds an unoccupied trailer hitched to a car on the side of the road, its metal hull ripped from the inside out. During his investigation, he hears a high-pitched buzz and has discovered a large, unusual animal footprint on the ground. On their way back to town, he finds that a general store has been wrecked and its owner mysteriously killed. Harold then explains that it was the descendant of an ant that was present when the atomic bomb was first tested in the desert in 1945 and mutated each generation by lingering radiation. Sound familiar? With the help of the Air Force, Harold instigates an aerial search of the desert for the creature's nest. When the nest is found, it is torched and its tunnels are gassed with cyanide. Number 4. The Thing, 1951. Just when we thought only giant radioactive lizards and insects could be a threat to humanity, what about giant radioactive vegetables? The movie begins as the military arrives at a base in Alaska. Carrington tells Pat about the landing of a large, mysterious object. He then shows Pat photographic images taken by a telescopic camera, and they fly out to the object's estimated location. Protruding up from an area of thin radioactive ice, they spot an airfoil and determine that it is attached to a circular craft, which they presume to be extraterrestrial, when they discover the presence of a large man-like creature buried nearby. To preserve the creature, the men cut it out of a block of ice and fly it back to the station. Later, while guarding the extraterrestrial, Corporal Barnes places an electric blanket over the ice, unaware that the blanket is turned on. Soon enough, the ice is melted and the creature is free as it flees into the snow. Barnes and the others watch in disbelief as the creature fights and kills two sled dogs before running off. Near one slain dog, the men find a severed arm of the creature and examine it in the laboratory. They conclude that the extraterrestrial is made of vegetable matter, but is highly intelligent. Then, when the severed hand begins to flex, the scientists realize that it is feeding off the dog's blood on its fingertips. Later, another scientist at the station stumbles into the room and announces that the thing attacked him and two of the others at the greenhouse, leaving the others hanging upside down with their throats slit. The creature, with its severed arm restored, surprises them at the greenhouse's inside door, but they manage to throw up a barricade before it can get out. In the nursery, Carrington tells the other researchers that the alien planted a seed in the greenhouse and it was feeding it with the dripping blood of its human victims. Carrington also reveals that he planted an alien seed found in the severed arm and shows them how it multiplied at a spectacular rate after being fed blood and plasma. Soon after, Pat questions Carrington's secretary about the disappearance of all the blood plasma supply. She reveals Carrington stole the blood supply, and Pat confronts the scientist, although he dismisses Carrington's plea that the life form must be researched. Pat is overruled as the order to preserve the alien finally comes through on the radio. Later, however, as the temperature becomes dangerously cold outside for the guards, the military realize they must kill the creature to save themselves, so they set up a trap by igniting kerosene. But the alien is only slowed down by the fire. That's when the decision is made to electrocute the alien. But as they are devising this new trap, the creature is shutting off the heat in the complex. For protection, the group moves into the generator room and quickly begins building the trap. As the extraterrestrial lumbers towards the generator room, lured by the smell of flesh, the alien unwittingly walks into the trap. Shocked with powerful electrical bolts, the creature slowly disintegrates to ash. Afterwards, a message is finally able to go out over the radio with a warning to keep watching the skies. Number 3. The Day the Earth Stood Still, 1951. The movie takes place in Washington, D.C., when an alien named Klaatu and his robot Gort land their flying saucer on the Capitol Mall, and the army quickly surrounds them. Klaatu comes in peace and with goodwill, and with a gift for the president to study life on other planets. But a nervous soldier inadvertently disrupts those plans and accidentally shoots the visiting alien, which sends the robot Gort into a frenzy. While being treated for his wounds at the hospital, Klaatu tells the president's secretary that he has a message that must be delivered to all the world's leaders simultaneously. But after the proposal is rejected, Klaatu is able to escape and seeks refuge in a boarding house. Klaatu seeks out Professor Barnhart, the smartest person on Earth. Barnhart listens to Klaatu's message for Earth and agrees to gather scientists from around the world to the saucer to hear Klaatu's message. He also suggests that Klaatu peacefully demonstrate the power he represents beforehand. The next day, for a half hour, Klaatu executed his peaceful demonstration of power as all electrical equipment on Earth, except for essential services, such as hospitals and aircraft in flight, ceased to function. Understanding the problem that may befall Klaatu, the boarding house owner, Helen, is entrusted with Klaatu's true purpose on Earth. Klaatu tells Helen that if anything should happen to him, she must go to Gort and say, "Klaatu Barada Nikto." The army, in hot pursuit of Klaatu, tracks them down, and Klaatu is shot and killed. His body is moved to the nearby police station. Helen rushes to the saucer and speaks Klaatu's phrase. Hearing the words, Gort retrieves Klaatu's body and revives him inside the saucer, even though his revival is only temporary. Klaatu tells Barnhart's assembled scientists that an interplanetary organization has created a police force of invincible robots like Gort. "In matters of aggression, we have given them absolute power over us," Klaatu concludes. "Your choice is simple. Join us and live in peace, or pursue your present course of action and face obliteration. We shall be waiting for your answer." And with that ominous warning, Klaatu and Gort depart in the saucer. Number 2. War of the Worlds, 1953.
"We welcome you! We're friends! Yeah!"
Finally, the Martians are here. This entry on the list started with the story written by H.G. Wells, first published in 1898. The story was later modified by Orson Welles when broadcast over the radio on Halloween night in 1938. The radio broadcast of the story took place in New York City instead of in London, where it had taken place in the book. And that radio broadcast caused quite a stir, as some people thought it was a real newscast. Once the story was made into a feature film in 1953, we finally got to see a science fiction spaceship in the form of the Martian War Machine that was perhaps the most imaginative and superb creation ever made for science fiction films at the time. Taking on an abstraction of the manta ray shape made for one of the most fascinating ships to see on the big screen to that point. A small town in California is attacked by the Martians, beginning a worldwide invasion. The residents of the small town are excited when a flaming meteor lands in the hills. Their joy, however, is quickly tempered when they discover that that meteor has passengers, and they are not at all friendly. As the meteors crash to Earth, it is quickly revealed that they house alien war machines that begin killing at random. The military is called in, but they're no match for the aliens' force field. However, the Martians are able to be wounded once they exit their spacecraft. It's the 20th century, and to the unsuspecting human population, Martians are appearing on Earth with destruction on their mind. While everyone panics, the Martians unleash a direct assault to our planet with hundreds of invulnerable ships. The invasion takes place all over the world, and all the major cities are destroyed one after one. Even with the atomic bomb being used against them, the Martians can't be stopped. So, if the humans can't beat them, who can? Maybe something much smaller? As in other versions of the story, whether the Martians start their attack in London, New York, or in California, whether the Martians have no use for humanity as the movie depicted, or want to use us as a blood supply for themselves, as portrayed in the book, the Martians always succumb to the real heroes of the story, terrestrial bacteria, which always brings about their downfall. Number 1. Forbidden Planet, 1956. While all the other entries on this list are fantastic, this movie is in its own category. It wasn't just a fantastic story with groundbreaking effects for the time. It was an inspirational film that inspired elements of Star Trek and Star Wars, along with aspects of the original Lost in Space and elements of the Doctor Who series, Planet of Evil, that were consciously based on Forbidden Planet. But probably the largest and most recognizable contribution that impacted the sci-fi genre at the time was Robbie the Robot. Robbie was the mechanical servant to the antagonist of the movie, Morbius, who had designed, built, and programmed Robbie using knowledge gleaned from his study of the ancient Krell, a long-extinct race of highly intelligent beings that once populated the planet Altair 4 that he was currently living on. But Robbie was more than just a mechanical servant. Turns out, he was very employable. Robbie appeared in over 40 films and television shows, and has a resume that would make any actor envious. Although the robot prop was created for Forbidden Planet, Robbie got a lot more screen time, including two episodes of the original Lost in Space series, and one episode of The Twilight Zone. And in some ways, you can see how Forbidden Planet directly influenced Lost in Space, especially when Robbie the Robot is reassembling the robot from Lost in Space on Lost in Space. Forbidden Planet follows Commander J.J. Adams and his crew as they are sent to investigate why there has been no communication from a previous mission to the planet Altair 4 explored 20 years earlier. Upon their arrival on Altair 4, Commander Adams eventually finds out there's only two survivors, Dr. Morbius and his daughter Altair. Unknown to Adams, Morbius has made a discovery of great power, and has no intention of sharing it with anyone. Within minutes, a high-speed dust cloud approaches. The vehicle has a robotic driver named Robbie. Robbie invites the members of the crew to Morbius's residence, where they meet Morbius and Altair for the first time. Morbius explains many of the old crew were torn limb from limb by a strange creature or force living on the planet. He goes on to explain about a race of creatures that lived on the planet called the Krell, and the Krell civilization collapsed 2,000 centuries ago, leaving behind the Brain Booster Machine and the Great Machine. Later that night, the crew has completed the security arrangements and tests the force field around the ship. But outside, something hits the fence and a series of foot-like depressions begin forming, leading up to the ship. The next day, as the crew waits, no one sees anything, until suddenly, weapons begin to fire despite the weapons being under the radar fire control. The controller confirms a hit, but the object is still moving towards the ship. Suddenly, something hits the force field, and the huge monster appears, outlined in the energy flux. The crew open fire, but it seems to do little good. After the attack, Adams and Doc go back to Morbius, and the Doc sneaks into Morbius' office to take the brain booster test, which ultimately severely injures him. Struggling to speak and in heavy pain, Doc explains that the Krell succeeded in their great experiment. However, they forgot about the subconscious monsters they would release. Monsters from the id. Morbius, stunned, begins to realize that he is the source of the creature that is killing him. The machine the Krell built was able to release the inner beast, the subconscious monster dwelling deep inside the ancestral mind. Unwittingly, Morbius releases the creature from his mind, which triggers the defense shields of his house. Morbius orders Robbie to destroy the creature. However, Robbie cannot, and short circuits, because Robbie knew the monster was Morbius himself. Retreating to the Krell lab, watching as the creature breaks through, a panicked Morbius rushes forward and denies the creature its existence. And just like that, the creature disappears, but not before fatally wounding Morbius. With his dying breath, he instructs Adams to trigger the self-destruct mechanism linked to the reactor of the great machine. The ship and the crew have 24 hours to get as far away from the planet as possible. The next day, we see the ship in space with Robbie piloting and Adams assuring Altair that her father's memory will shine like a beacon. And there you have it, Planeteers. We hope you enjoyed our top 10 movies of the 1950s. Please let us know in the comments below if we should have included another entry, as there were so many to choose from. Please be sure to subscribe to our channel and drop a like and share this video, and don't forget to smash that bell for alerts. You can also catch us on social media. We're on Twitter at Sci-Fi More, we're on Instagram at Sci-Fi and More, and on Facebook at Mike Cosmos Sci-Fi and More. Until next time, Planeteers, have a great galactic day.